So, hello to everyone who's already logged in. I can still see participants coming in, which is like so typical of a regular meeting always. People streaming in with their coffee cups, I hope, because we'll be starting in another minute. And it is my immense pleasure to introduce Dr. Florence Martin, who is joining us from North Carolina in the USA. It's 7:30 a.m. there, and she's up early to join us. And we had to, schedule this so that the times matched. And like I have been saying in my communication when we were talking about this webinar, most of you might be knowing Dr. Florence from the time in 2013 when we set up our eUNIV platform and she visited our campus and trained many of you on Moodle and other aspects of online teaching. And this morning I had sent out a message, Florence, saying that when we set up eUNIV, that was a choice. But now online learning is the and teaching is the need of the hour. And it's so great that you're back with us to tell us more. In online learning by your faculty and other people who are in
Ashu ma'am, you have to unmute yourself. I am muting all, right? As of now. I request all of you not to unmute yourself until unless you have a question to pose, right? So Ashu ma'am, you can unmute yourself, yeah.
Okay, so let me introduce formally Dr. Florence to all of you. Dr. Florence is a professor in learning, design and technology and the Program Director for the Postmaster Certificate of University and College Teaching Program at the University of North Carolina. She has received her doctorate and master's degrees in educational technology from Arizona State University. And she has lots of publications, presentations to her credit, and runs a lots of interesting programs related to this. She has also written a book on digital media and online learning, and has contributed several chapters to other books. So I will not be taking any more time because this is more like a learning session. I would invite her to start her talk, and I hope all of us will have a very interesting sessions. And the question and answers can be posted on the chat as we go. Dr. Kamal will be collating them at some point in between the presentation and at the end of the session, we'll be taking questions for Dr. Florence. So Florence, I request you to start.
Thank you, Ashu. Thank you for the introduction. Just one more quick thing to add. If any of you would like to get to know more about my work, there is the website on this opening slide. It's www.florencemartin.net. And as Ashu said, I research primarily in the area of online learning these days. So there's a wealth of articles out there. Some of them are open source, some are not. So, I mean, check them out. I would encourage you to, always going back to research to inform our teaching is a great practice. So if you want to access any of the articles, that's a good place to go to under publications. So quickly, before we get started, I know we have 127 participants logged in. And I think your name automatically displays when you type me a message. I would love to know what you teach. Just tell me, in a couple of words, what you teach and what is your goal for learning today? Thanks to all of you who've been taking the time to type. And Kamal, the chat window should default show up, right, on my end, even though I'm in the screen share mode.
Yeah, ma'am, you have to click on the chat mode.
That's what I did. Okay, hang on.
There would be a tab called.
Oh, I see it now.
Full screen. Full screen. Yeah.
Yeah. Since I was in full screen, no, I'll go full screen. Since I was in the full screen, it's taking up my It's blocking my chat window.
Yeah, yeah. It's so now okay. It should be fine. Yeah.
It's okay. So here is our quick agenda, and I'll look through the chat, So we'll briefly talk about what is online learning, and then, you know, I've sectioned the presentation into best practices for these six different aspects. Course design, course communication, technical, time management, synchronous online environments, and we'll finally wrap it up with online course assessment and evaluation, because that's another one of the aspects, of online teaching. So what is online learning? I teach graduate level courses at University of North Carolina, Charlotte, and I teach 100% online even on any given day, so I don't get to see my students face to face. And so I never thought a day would come and the entire world would be teaching online. What I'm going to share today is my experiences as an online instructor from my experience as an online researcher. Okay. And so hopefully you all can also benefit from it. So here is a definition that I like. This is a pretty old definition. It's from 2008, but it's still very applicable. Okay. What is online learning? So Ali defines online learning as a use of internet to access learning materials to interact with the content, instructor, and the learners. So three aspects of interaction: content, instructor, and other learners too, right? And to obtain support during the learning process. So the learners are not doing this in a self-paced format, right? Just by themselves in isolation. We are all involved in this learning process in order to acquire knowledge, to construct personal meaning, and to grow from the learning experience. The end, that's what it is. So they are learning the knowledge and then they are constructing meaning out of it. They have to know how to apply and then grow from the learning experience. So online learning is just more than, just presentation of delivery materials using the web. Like, for example, immediately, when we see online learning, folks tend to think whatever you do in the face-to-face can just be put on the, on an LMS and we can call it online learning. It takes a little more effort than that. You have to adapt your instruction so that, there is still interaction and there's learning happening in the online environment. The learner and the learning process should be the focus of online learning. So in a traditional environment, a lot of time, the emphasis is more teacher-centered a lot of times. And I think we are slowly moving away with the emphasis being more learner-centered. In the online environment, the emphasis is so much on the learner, right? The teacher takes actually the backstage. We become more of a facilitator. So that's where, the shift in from the teacher center to the learner centered or student center happens. So two approaches. You're probably already familiar with these two terms, if not good time, to be familiar. So synchronous and asynchronous learning. Synchronous and asynchronous online learning. Prior to the current institution I'm teaching at, now I teach asynchronously online and I do some synchronous, here and there. But whereas in my previous institution, I thought primarily synchronous. I think both has benefits, both has challenges. And, you have to see, for your context and for your learners, which works better and how much of synchronous and how much of asynchronous you want to do. Because there is a room for asynchronous learning as well. So if you can do the parts, asynchronous and then supplement it with synchronous, that works too. That's what I do these days. So synchronous learning, what is synchronous learning? So right now what we are doing is synchronous. You're all in real time. It's 7:30 in the morning for you. It's 5 o'clock in the evening there in Solon. And you're all logged in into the Zoom room. So that is a perfect example of synchronous learning and in real time via the internet. Whereas asynchronous has the time delay capabilities. So you use Moodle there, you're systematically creating instruction and putting it on the on the LMS and then have students go in and look at it at their own time. So that is called as asynchronous online learning. So we will look at benefits from both. So in synchronous, So that's, I think, a screenshot of Centra, an old screenshot. So, you know, it has a lot of capabilities. You know, for those of you, I heard that you use BigBlueButton. Lot of functionalities. It's usually similar across platforms. You're able to do a text chat. You're able to do audio and video. Again, that depends on the bandwidth and, you know, if all your students are able to connect. There is data and application sharing. You could share PowerPoints, you could share websites, any other resources, any demonstrations you want to do, you can. You can share whiteboard, right? You can draw on a whiteboard. You could do virtual hand raising, you know, ask questions. You could do periodic check-ins. I mentioned presentations already. And if you want to do small group activities, you could do breakout rooms, right? Breakout rooms, put them in small groups to have a conversation that may or may not happen in the large class, depending on how large your class is. So those are some of the tools that are used in Synchronous. So the advantage of doing Synchronous is the real time, right? So there's that you're able to see your student face to, like, you know, not face to face, but, you know, through audio and video. And then there's that immediacy. So if your student has a question, you can immediately answer. So definitely it has its advantage. But then imagine, you know, the student has to sit in through like so many lectures from so many instructors all day long in front of the computer when, you know, their internet is not at its best. So it has its challenges. So that's where asynchronous comes into play, right? So you could look into this. So in asynchronous, the backbone is an LMS, right? A learning management system. And you have Moodle over there. This is a screenshot from Moodle. So what are some of the functionalities in an LMS? You could send an announcement. You could email your students. You could upload files, right? You could put up recorded lectures. So instead of listening to you live, you know, you are still doing the same thing, but you're recording yourself and you're going to host it on, you know, the LMS so that the student can go in and listen to you at their own convenient time. And then you create modules, like, you know, for the lessons, you create modules. And then you could do threaded discussions for collaboration, other Web 2.0 activities. There's a lot of external tools, even outside of Moodle, that you can use to really engage the learner and for them to interact. And then you could collect assignments. You know, this is a great functionality, right? So when I started teaching here in the US, students used to give me assignments on a floppy disk. You know, that doesn't happen anymore. You know, for those of you who remember that, you know, we even had floppy disks, right? So now I tell them, I don't take assignments in any other format. Don't email them to me because you want to keep it all in the LMS so that then you can track your grades and, you know, maintain the online grade book. So that's a neat functionality, you know, to get the work from the students submitted through the LMS. And then you could do quizzes, right? That's another great functionality within the LMS. There's a lot more, you know, I'm just mentioning a few. So the advantage of asynchronous learning is anytime, anywhere. So synchronous is in real time, whereas asynchronous is anytime, anywhere. So you could be anywhere, you know, and anytime, right? That anytime capability is not there in synchronous, but whereas in asynchronous that exists and it's convenient, you know, both for the instructor and the student. But then, you know, even with asynchronous, you still have to know how to manage your schedule well and, you know, all that is still important. Those challenges come and, you know, we'll talk about some of that going in this presentation today. So here's an organization I want to introduce you all to. Actually, it used to be called Sloan Consortium. Now they are called Online Learning Consortium. And they are leaders in the area of online learning and have done extensive research specifically on online learning. And I mean, you can pull up, they have a journal called Online Learning, which is free. And so that's it's open access, I should say. So anybody can, you know, access any of their articles. And they also have a wealth of other resources on the website if you want to check it out. But what I want to show you today is this classification. I always show this, you know, at any of the sessions that I do to set the stage. So if you look in a traditional classroom, so proportion of content delivered online is at 0%. So this is course with no online technology, content is delivered in writing or orally. Technically, none of us should be there, okay? Like pandemic or no pandemic, I think, you know, we all should at least try to be in the next category, web facilitated. Because think of, you know, the current day, and especially in India, we are leaders in technology, right? We are leaders, and I think we have the largest number of engineers developed, computer scientists. So, you know, we have access to these resources. So this 1 to 29% is called web facilitated. The courses that use web-based technology to facilitate a face-to-face course. So, you know, you're still teaching face-to-face, but you're using web-based platforms to supplement, you know, activities, to engage, to collaborate. All kinds of things are happening. So that's called the web facilitated, which is a nice place to be in on any given day. Then comes blended and a hybrid. So this is a step about 30 to 79%. So in the US, again, you know, here too, we see courses all across the spectrum. Here I recommend people, you know, you want to strive to be in the blended and hybrid place. So this is a course that blends online and face-to-face delivery, where a substantial portion of the content is delivered online and has a reduced number of face-to-face meetings. So there's a good balance between online and face-to-face. The terminology means the same, blended or hybrid. Some folks call it blended, some folks call it hybrid. And then, so that's 30 to 79%. Above 80%, where most of the content is delivered online, no face-to-face meetings. So this is where I fall under, you know, because I don't get to meet my students face to face. So, you know, this is a category, you know, online courses, and this is becoming very popular in the US because, you know, we are able to reach students who don't live locally, right? So for me, you know, I have students from all over. That's because, you know, we are able to teach online who don't, you know, have to come to campus to take the class. So, you know, it has its set of advantages for that. So I hope, you know, this kind of gives you an idea of web facilitate, traditional, web facilitated, blended, hybrid, and online. So here is one framework I want to introduce. It comes out of this article, which is one of my pieces. You know, it was an interesting study we did. What I did was I interviewed about eight faculty who had won awards for online teaching. Right? So it was interesting to, you know, hear from their perspective. And then this is a framework we created. So online learning has three aspects: the design aspect, the facilitation aspect, and an assessment and evaluation aspect, right? Three different aspects. So there's a lot of guidelines on how to design. And, you know, you have to really put in a lot of thought to design, online course. But then it doesn't stop there. You know, you also have to be present to facilitate, right? So that's critical. And then, you know, the assessment and evaluation also blends in. So all these three aspects are very critical to online teaching. And so what I want to do next is move forward to discuss some best practices. And to do that, again, I'm referring to one of my other articles. And this is one I would highly recommend you to take a look. And you all, several of you completed the survey. You know, I sent it out because I thought it might be interesting for you to look at some of the items and rate yourself. And hopefully I'm tying this presentation today directly to, you know, what you completed. You know, even though this is titled Faculty Readiness, you know, it's faculty readiness. What are some essential competencies for a faculty to be ready, to help them be ready to teach online, right? So we categorized into four different aspects: course design, course communication, technical, and time management. So I'm housing, you know, all the elements in this, and then we'll go one by one and look at it. Okay, that's what we're going to do. So, and what I'll do is at the end of each section, maybe I will stop and, you know, we can see if there are questions and we can try and answer. And Ashu ma'am had sent me the slides that the MBA group had created. And, you know, I really liked some of your great ideas. I think, you know, you had conceptualized learning, engagement, and assessment, which are three essential aspects, and also some of the elements, you know, for online learning within it, you know, use of OERs, collaboration. Those are all excellent, you know, ideas. And you will see that, you know, I reinforce some of that in the presentation today. So looking at course design, which is very, very important. So, you know, when you walk in face to face, you know, you have all the knowledge in your head. right? You do lesson planning, you know, you have presentations, but you can adjust your lesson spontaneously when you're teaching, right? When you're in a classroom. There isn't an online that, it's hard to do that, right? So you have to really be prepared and you have to have a good structure, put it up online so that especially students are not in front of you to ask questions, you know, if there's any clarification they need. So it has to be really clearly laid out. So that's a big difference between traditional and online. So in for course design, the first thing I would recommend, you know, actually there are 9 items. And what I'll do is I have an individual slide for each of these items. Okay, so let's just go through that. So course orientation. So in an online, in a face-to-face class, you know, probably several of you take the first day in your semester to walk through your syllabus, you know, give them details about the class, right? What's coming up. So if you're teaching a course online, I mean, from the first day of the semester, you know, in this case, I think several of you had to like switch midway. I think that's what happened here in the US. You know, we had to switch midway in March. So, but you know, an orientation is always helpful to set the stage. Like a quick video, you know, walking them through the Canvas shell, or and I'll share an example of a course shell. You know, hopefully you all will be able to see it. I do this. This is a YouTube video. You know, I record it and then I just upload it to YouTube. Giving them, setting them, like telling them the purpose, how does grading happen, what type of activities are involved. So all that can go under course orientation. It does not have to be a video. I like doing a video because then students can also see and hear me. But you could also do it text-based if you prefer, you know, to do it a text and you want students to read it. So course orientation is very important. Second one, you know, a lot of these items, you know, that I'm walking you through in design, applies not only for online learning, it applies for blended learning, it also applies for face-to-face learning. Because what I'm walking you through in design is the systematic design of instruction, okay? So along with researching on online learning, I'm an educational technologist, so I prepare instructional designers. I think in India, you know, I think we don't have an emphasis on this area a lot yet. But here, we prepare instructional designers who work in corporate and higher ed. And so what they do is it's about the systematic design of instruction so that, you know, learning and engagement can be effective. So one thing that, you know, we stress in this process is writing measurable objectives. Right. So, and you probably have objectives given to you. You probably have standards that you use, that you align your curriculum, you know, you have that. So if you look at my course goals, so I use the term course goals and course objectives. These can be interchangeably used, you know, learning outcomes. So goals are usually broad items. So I have 5 goals in this course. Okay. So this is from a teaching and learning course that I just thought, you know, so you see how I'm asking them either to identify, review, analyze, examine, discuss. So these are all things that I want them to do. So when they finish this semester, they should exactly be able to do that, right? So goals are so important because that is what you can then assess them on. Are they able to identify key principles? Are they able to discuss innovation and scholarship in teaching and learning? You know, so whatever you want them to be able to do. So if you say you want your students to understand, what does understand mean? It's within their head. You know, they may not be able to show it in an external way, right? So refer to Bloom's taxonomy and, you know, looking up some measurable verbs for, you know, writing your goals and objectives is very important. So that is for goals. And then if you look down at the bottom, I have something called as weekly objectives. So you have broad goals, but then coming in, you know, into each module, you could have objectives. So objectives, do you see? They are a little bit more like, you know, so the goals are broader and these are more specific. And then at the end of each objective, I even have them aligned to the goals. So, you know, when a student reads an objective at the beginning of a lesson, define instructional strategies. Okay. Then they know, oh, okay, so this is about goal 2, you know, where I need to be able to review instructional strategies and best practices that influence effective teaching in higher education. Okay, so having measurable goals and objectives are very important in your course design. That's where you start. Then comes, activities. You want to design activities that support your goals and objectives, right? You can have a variety of activities. So this is an example discussion activity. I do a lot of discussions because, I don't see them face to face. So they're online and LMS has the functionality to discussions. When you do discussions, only thing is you have to be very clear in your requirements. I tell them, you can see, minimum of 300 words, use APA references, here are the two questions, you need to respond by this date, and then you have to respond to your peers by this date, and I give them a rubric how I'm going to grade them, right? So being very clear in your expectations is very important when you teach online. And you can have a variety of activities. So this is just one, right? I said discussions, you could have them do write something on a wiki, you could have them like create something, you could have them do a PowerPoint, they're all activities. As long as, you're very clear, give them exactly, what you want them to do and how, they're going to be graded on. And that's equally important. And then comes organizing instructional material. The sequence, I think you probably do the material before the activities. So for material, when you create your course on Moodle, you want to chunk them, right? You can't put all your resources on one page. Students will probably be lost. So I like doing weekly modules. I know some faculty do like bi-weekly, or they combine 2-3 weeks together in a module. I split it into weeks because I realized when I combine, content together, students will always wait till the end to really get into it close to the due date. So, every week I tell them, so I have something called as a landing page, so that's what, when you click on that week one overview, they will see, my introduction, my objectives, my tasks, what they have to do, and then what I refer to as an e-lesson is an instructor generated like a lesson, and I'll show you, I think I have a screenshot of that. And then I make them do a discussion. This varies, it doesn't have to look exactly like this. So whatever works for you, whatever content you teach, whatever works for you. What I'm saying is you want it clearly organized and chunked, okay? So that's a very important aspect of course design. So this is like, an instructor generated video. So this is my, lesson for my instructional strategies. You can create, and I clearly, I did it in red, the reuse, because the advantage of teaching online or even hybrid, once you create a video, you don't have to recreate it every year, especially if the content is the same, right? If the content doesn't change drastically. So, I reuse it. So what I recommend is, so in your video, you want to focus on the content and not on all other class management stuff, right? So if you're talking about class management, this assignment, that assignment and all that, then it becomes very specific to that particular semester, then gets harder to be reused. So focus on the content. So students love listening to the instructor, in this case, my recommendation and also from research, you don't want to have really long videos. You can talk to them for 2 hours, but then, if you can do the same in 15 to 30 minutes max, 15 minutes even. So what I do is I synthesize everything and I give it to them, especially if you're recording it. Right? Because, I make sure there are other resources, but then, this is a recording of the synthesis of everything. So you see, this was it's a 14 minute long video. Okay. So, so you could record, but you could also look up for open educational resources, right? If there are resources on instructional strategies, you don't have to always recreate. It's nice for them to hear from you. So you definitely need to have, it's nice to have some of your own videos, but you could also, look for resources that are out there. There are so many portals out there that you could look for depending on the content that you teach, and, look for instructional resources. And then I want to say, so in course design, we use different teaching methods, right? So especially for online. So some comparison, in face-to-face, the learning happens in a classroom setting. Online learning is more individual. Even if you bring them synchronous together and there is some collaborative learning, a lot of time, they're processing it by themselves. And then in online, so when you do, synchronous, there is some, Whereas in asynchronous, there's no immediacy, right? So if they are watching your video or they are reading something, they cannot immediately ask you a question. So there is a difference there. In face-to-face, usually there's no pacing. They have to really keep up with your pace, right? Then they take notes and listen to you. In online learning, if they're watching something, they can pause, right? At least in asynchronous, they can pause. They can watch a video 3 times if they want, if they really want to get the concepts. So they have the functionality for pacing. In face-to-face, there is no technology. I mean, they may or may not have the technology, whereas in online, technology becomes a requirement. So those are just some key differences I brought. The reason I mentioned that is, you know, so now you have room to use different teaching methods, different types of presentations. So what you were doing when you were teaching face-to-face doesn't have to be the same when you're teaching online. Your presentation techniques, you know, can be adjusted. And the same, you know, collaborative activities. You might have been doing some active learning and, you know, group activities and face-to-face, but then this collaboration in an online setting is going to look different, right? So you have to rethink that. How does collaboration looks online? How can I put people in teams together, right? So that's important. And same way assessment, right? So assessment in face-to-face, I think in India, you know, I did till my undergrad in India. So I am familiar with, you know, how I was taught a very traditional end of year exams I had to write. And then when I came here to the US, I had to get adjusted to the system of education where we do a lot of check-ins. You know, we don't wait until the end of the year, you know, a lot of different check-ins. Maybe things have changed now. You know, it's been 20 years since, you know, I moved on. So I don't know, and there's a variety, you know, of schools in India, so I can't generalize. But then, you know, so think about, you know, how else can you support your students? So, you know, how can we use more formative assessments, right? In addition to one end of year summative assessment. So, you know, the thing is, you know, for us when we teach, we have to think about formative assessment is you're able to give feedback. You know, it's still an assessment. You're supporting students learning, you know, that's the goal end of the day. And then summative assessment is you're judging, you know, the overall performance. But then we should be involved in also giving that, you know, formative feedback and assessing our students periodically so that, you know, we can give them feedback and help them grow in their learning. So quizzes and tests are a great way, you know, talking about formative assessments. You can use it for formative as well as summative, you know. You can give them feedback and, you know, this is just a getting started quiz. You know, I teach a grad level course on teaching and learning, so I don't do a lot of quizzes, but this is just, I even do a getting started quiz at the beginning so that they read my syllabus, you know, so they know exactly what they have to do in an online course. So that's just a screenshot from that. You know, and you know, when they are doing a quiz online, you know that, you know, they might have access to all the resources, whether it's closed book or not, you don't know, right? So you have to just mentally, you know, think that through. Okay, if they are accessing resources, maybe I need to give them less time, you know, if you really want them to be prepared, right? Password protected, timed, you know, so that, you know, and so you just think through all those, or maybe the questions could be harder, or maybe the questions are more application focused. You know, so one thing, you know, the Bloom's taxonomy, if you look at the different levels, you know, we always don't have to test only for facts and concepts, right? We can move down and we can have them apply, analyze, create, you know, so these are things that we are having them learn the content, but then give them scenarios and see how they can apply in it. So that's very important so that you can individualize it and, you know, for them to really take it and apply it. Online assignments. So now, you know, you're also thinking about along with tests, like projects, you know, they can write papers, do presentations, do projects, problem solve a situation. So this class I teach, you know, so my content area is unique. I make them develop an online course, right? Or a course, matter of fact, whatever way they want to teach. So they're literally building it, right? They're building something for me to see. And they give me a link for, you know, for me to review it. So so that is so unique, right? They're learning everything, all the content, and they are putting it together in terms of a project. In the end, you know, it's very application oriented. And, you know, what I remember from, you know, my graduate school days is all the projects that I did hands-on, I still remember them, Because I think, you know, learning-wise, there's a more transfer, much more transfer into the real world, right? And that is what we want. When students move from one semester to another, that transfer of knowledge is so important. So, you know, so moving on along that, you know, on the Bloom's taxonomy is very important. Managing grades online is critical. I told you, right? I tell students, I will not take submissions over email, you know, even though that's electronic, because it has to come through the LMS. And then so that I can directly, this is just a random gradebook because I didn't want to give you a copy of my student gradebook, you know, because it's confidential. When you create an assignment, it automatically creates an item in the grade. So everything is so aligned. Everything is so transparent. Students clearly know how you're grading, you know, the semester. So those are things, you know, very important in an online course design. And then instructional alignment. So this is a big one. Actually, this was not in the rubric, but then I added it. You know, this is the most important part. If there is one thing, you know, if I can tell you to take away from today's presentation, it would be instructional alignment. So when you create a course, you want to make sure there's alignment between objectives, your instructional materials, your activities, and your assessment. I talked about all four, right? So activities are more formative. Assessment can be summative, formative and summative. So objectives, goals and objectives where you start with, they need to know what they can achieve at the end of the week or end of the module. And then you give them the instructional material and then you give them the activities so that, you know, they can really master the material, and then there's the assessment. So, you know, there is this framework called Quality Matters, if any of you have heard about it. It is a certification program designed, you know, to review the quality of online courses. And this is what they stress on. So many, you know, of their sections is about instructional alignment. You know, so this, you know, as you can clearly see, this is not applicable only for online, right? This totally goes in for our face-to-face classroom teaching too. So I wanted to really take a minute to stress. So now would be a good time, you know, so this is a summary. Now would be a good time for questions. If you have questions, you know, type in the chat window. So to summarize, I would say, prepare to spend more time than you would in a traditional course. But, you know, the good part is, even if you spend time creating the first semester you teach it, keep in mind, you can reuse your content, right? That's the great part, you know, so even if you go back to teaching face-to-face or teaching webinars, which is where, you know, I hope all of you move to webinars or at least blended and hybrid, you know, you want to, you know, spend time and then seek out successful models. I think the fact that you're all logged in today to listen to me shows that you're interested and invested in this, you know, learning more about how to do online learning, you know, look at example courses. So those are important. Build simple and logical navigation, right? I talked about chunking, keep it simple. If a student does not know where to find what, you will lose the student, right? And you don't see the student face to face. So keep it simple and logical, small accessible pieces, set clear expectations. You know, you have to like really lay it all out for them. Test everything before you send it. Because, you know, like if otherwise, you, if you don't really thoroughly test it, then they, you know, things can be broken and not working the way it should be. So just, you know, keep that in mind. So before we go into communication, I want to take a minute to look at the chat and also, okay.
So Florence ma'am, I would like, just like to assist you in this. So there are the questions, there are a lot of questions in the chat, and most of them are like cornered around three or four things. So the primary question that I found in all the questions is like the engagement of the students. So most of the people are like asking that, how do we maintain the engagement or the interest level and the motivation level of the students in online lectures? Because
great question, but that's what we're going to talk about in the next section.
Okay, so
all about, you know, communication facilitation, which is all about engagement, right?
Right.
So I can point, you know, even from design, you could still engage your learner, right? So like when you do your own videos, keep them brief and straight to the point. That is engaging the learner. So even in the design of your instruction, you know, in the choice of your activities, you can engage your learner, right?
Right.
The activities. So, you know, and when you're able to create activities that totally apply, you know, to them, and when they can see the transfer, that's another way, you know, you're engaging the learner. So even in design, you can also, you know, definitely engage. And, you know, some of the things I talked about, keeping like the modules clear, chunk, you know, those are also ways. So if you put like a lot of resources, like, you know, for 5 weeks together and have them do it, then, so that they might be a little more disengaged. So in design, I think there are aspects for engagement, but then we'll talk a little bit more in communication. Anything else that
So somewhat related to the question, regarding the student divide. So they said, how do we engage the, there are some slow learners, there are some fast learners, there are some backbenchers. So I see quite a bit of questions around that also. So how do we differentiate between them? How do we teach them according to their levels? So that is another question that is popping up quite often.
Okay, so a couple of things come to mind, and you know, and that happens everywhere, right? In any classroom, be it face-to-face. So my first thing is, I would love to hear what you do when a divide like that happens in your face-to-face classroom, right? Because I'm sure even in your face-to-face classroom.
Florence, if anybody wants to answer that, maybe that will be more engaging. Somebody wants to answer that?
Yeah, I would love to hear your perspective.
Yeah, so.
And you just answer that. Somebody, please. Nobody's volunteering.
Oh, you could type even, you know, if you don't want to pick up the line. Yeah.
So,
but generally,
can I just say something?
Sure.
So, what I wanted to say is that, we are saying that slow learner and the fast learner. It happens in face-to-face class also. Some students are slow and some are fast learner. But here in online mode, I think that the slow learner have the greater advantage. They can see the video again and again, which has been recorded, the type of work Ashu ma'am, we are doing right now, right? Lecture is getting recorded, slow learn. It is a great help for them. They can see it again and again. That's what I wanted to add.
Excellent point. So, you know, one thing from my experience I've seen, when you teach face-to-face, I've taught face-to-face, okay? Though I don't teach face-to-face now. I teach a lot of faculty development face-to-face, you know? So, so when you teach students face-to-face, not everybody will ask questions. So, you know, there are some students who are, you know, very want to interact and engage, whereas some who really like think through things, you know, takes the process. In an online setting, you might find the ones who are not as interactive in a class, face-to-face class, are ones who are really interactive in an online setting. So, you know, you might even see that difference because, you know, they have the time like to process. And as the ma'am just mentioned, you know, now you can really go back and take the time to read, reread, or process it, and then come back and ask questions. Couple of other things that comes to mind, you know, differentiating instruction is a great way. I don't know if, you know, you use that in your teaching. So one thing I do is, especially when it's projects, you know, I create activities such that they can, like, you know, depending on their interest, you know, you're giving a number of topics for them to pick from. Topics or scenarios. So depending on their interest, they are able to connect more with it. So irrespective of, you know, slow, fast, again, I don't know if those, how we categorize that, right? So that is one strategy that, you know, that helps. And then also maybe if you're doing synchronous, maybe think about putting them into groups. You know, you don't want to say they are all slow learners and put them to each other in groups. The reason I'm telling you, put them in groups, maybe like for them to have a discussion, maybe sometimes, you know, a small group conversation, learning from each other, that can also be helpful. You know, so to me, learning, and also I teach at the graduate level, so it's a little different, you know, when you teach undergrad level. So learning can happen. And this is like referring back to Michael Moore's framework. He's a guru on distance education. There has to be three types of interaction. One is learner-instructor, which is, you know, very important, we all know. So that is where they interact with us and learn from us. But there's also the learner-learner interaction. You know, they learn from each other. You know, it's very important. And, you know, then there is the learner content where they're directly going into the content. So all three aspects are important in any learning environment. So maybe, you know, pacing, you know, you know, depending on the different types of interactions that are made available to them, they will really get involved in it.
So two more questions.
Yeah.
Two more questions related to design. I think so there are some other questions which we'll come to later with the other topics. But okay. One very basic question was from Manju, who said that, you know, Bloom's taxonomy is something that we've been following for the last 70 years. Do we need to follow that, or do we need to modernize it? Are there any new theories on
I think it still works. You know, it's like just basic, you know, how to write measurable, you know, objectives and goals and what you want your learners to get in the end, right? I think in that aspect, I don't think we have changed. It's, I think, you know, it's still a grounding framework. There's a lot of other theories, you know, that will be a whole another conversation.
Okay. And the second thing,
you know, designing learning.
That when you have very technical subjects, science subjects, where, you know, explaining of concepts becomes very challenging. In such cases, how can we design courses like that? And for example, practical content.
Yeah. Labs are always hard, you know, so that's the toughest thing even here, you know, how do we do labs? So I think, you know, there are other additional software used for that. I don't deal with that personally, you know, directly. But you know, there's a lot of simulated applications that you could use. I forget some of the names. You know, we curated a whole list, and I'm actually going to go off this full screen mode. Give me a minute.
Talked about virtual labs and stuff, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm actually pulling up.
No, we have that list. We can pull it up for our teachers.
You have that list? Did you see that list? Yeah, a lot of, and I have some resources on this, I can say. There was a list that was sent, a curated list of virtual labs.
Yes.
So I think, you know, some of the simulations are definitely helpful in that, teaching applied content.
What about, in general, when you're dealing with very technical stuff, does design have a specific, you know, you need to pay some specific attention to some areas when you're designing for like science and tough subjects?
So, I've lost my slide. No, I think definitely, you know, depending on your content, and I can't specifically speak for a specific subject, you know, because I don't have the expertise in a specific subject. I would recommend you to do is look for resources, articles, you know, in that particular content area. If you're talking about science, how are other science faculty teaching, you know, the same content? I think, you know, the common ground will be the same, but there might be some specific strategies that work for science. So I think this is where, you know, even for you to talk among each other, you know, having a group conversation among the other science faculty, or if you're teaching engineering topics, you know, having a conversation among each other, what has worked, what has not worked, will help. I'm sure there are unique aspects to each of your, you know, particular topics. But, you know, definitely, I agree, each topic comes with its challenges. But then when you're talking about concepts and facts, I think, you know, doing interactive videos, giving periodic check-ins, you know, those will work irrespective of the content, right?
Right.
So hoping that will work, but then also you will have to look for other strategies. Top of my head, I don't think, you know, I have recommendations, but you know, that document that I was just looking at actually has resources by subject area. So I will definitely send that as well, so that, you know, you can go in and work.
So we can move
simulations, you know, I can definitely think of more simulations.
Yeah, so we can move to the next section.
We'll move forward. Yeah. I know this is taking a lot more time. Right?
No, there are, so now the questions are like more of technical nature. So
okay. So communication.
So it's like
these two are the most important, you know. So I think getting through these two will be the. So here I have 10 different things. Sending an announcement, you know. So this is like the question about engaging. How do you engage? So your students should know how, like, that you are there, you know, even if they don't see you, they should hear from you. So you can see, you know, but you don't want to overdo it too. You know, you don't want to email them 4 times in a day. So put it together, you know, send periodic announcements, right? Very, very important. And use the announcement functionality in the LMS. Create and moderate discussions. So when you do discussions, be there. Right? If it is a really large class and if it's hard for you to be there, assign facilitators. That's something I do. You know, I have others who are, you know, they have to pick to be a facilitator for each week. Then, you know, they kind of engage and, you know, there is interaction going on. So so you want, you know, to have thought-provoking questions and a conversation going on when there is a discussion. So that is an important strategy to have. So be there, be present, and then, you know, have others who will also support moderation. Use email to communicate. You know, I don't know how it is there, if, you know, you use email even on a regular basis with your students, but then, you know, you want to remind them to check email, communicate periodically. And if you think that they are not logging in, you know, you can check the analytics, right? When they last logged in, then you want to reach out and communicate to them, you know? So that is very important, you know, to, so that you're showing, you know, individually that you can engage with the learner. So this is another one that I really stress on. Two things, you know, responding to student questions. So depending on your class size, what I do is I create a forum called Contact the Instructor Forum. And I tell them, if the question is very general, you know, it's about the whole course, anybody can benefit from it, put your question in the forum so that, you know, when I respond, everybody can see it, because this will avoid or it'll help you not responding to 50 emails, right? Or 100 emails, how many ever students you use. So I use that strategy and it's always worked, you know, so monitor that periodically. But then if it is a question personal in nature, about their particular grade or about their work, you know, then you want them to email it to you. So explain to them, you know, your mode of preference. And then also when they email you, you want to let them know way ahead, how long will you take to respond? Because, you know, since they are not in front of you anymore, it is important for them to know when they can hear from you. Because sometimes students think, you know, they email and in 5 minutes they can hear back. Right. So I tell, you know, the standard I tell is 48 hours. That's 2 full days, you know, and you can build in, if weekend comes in, you know, you can have your own policy on how that works. And then in assignment grading, I usually say 7 days, because, you know, in online, it also builds on each other. Right. So you want them to have feedback right away, so that then it can build on and, you know, you're not waiting too long to give them feedback. Also, as an instructor, it's important for you too, because the more you wait to grade and give feedback, more work is going to get accumulated on your end. So that is equally important for you as well. So responding to student questions is important. Feedback, I talked about it. Have very clear criteria. This is something I would recommend. I think there is some feedback. Oh, probably because you unmuted them. Okay. So give very clear grading criteria, you know, telling them, you know, when they're working on an activity or an assignment, what you would want them to do, how many points, and, you know, you could have different level, like rubrics or a criteria too. You know, rubrics is different levels, like, you know, and then depending on what they've done, where they fall under. So providing feedback on assignments is very important. And I would say that is the hardest too. Okay. So in facilitation, that is definitely the hardest. And then use synchronous web conferencing tools for engagement again. You know, so if you're teaching a lot asynchronously, this is a nice engaging platform. You know, they come together and talk to each other. We use a lot of the features, right? So that's another communication technique. So that's just a screenshot from Zoom, but you know, use the variety of, you know, techniques to engage your learners. And then communicate expectations about student behavior. You know, these three are very probably context specific, so you can take it as it applies to India. So you know, here we are expected, you know, to really include this in our syllabus, because when you move online, sometimes, you know, students think, oh, learning is different, and you know, so you want to have really clear guidelines for communication, for email. You know, we call it as netiquette, right? Like etiquette, it's the online etiquette, which is netiquette for conversations. So, you know, having some of this in your policies is very important. So if when they move online, they're still talking to real people, you know, so they still have to be courteous and polite, and so all that good stuff. Academic integrity policies are very important. Cheating, fabrication and falsification, multiple submissions, you know, plagiarism. So these are the things that can, you know, really take shape in an online setting. So you want to stress on academic integrity. So I think this is an area, you know, what we do here is we have university-wide policies on these. So then, you know, we share it in a syllabus, so students have to abide by it. Academic dishonesty, you know, so these are things important for us to look at. So what I do is in my syllabus, I have a folder, I have a page called student resources, and you know, I have links to all these. What are my communication expectations and academic integrity? Under that, you know, so I talk about both these things that I just mentioned. Copyright and fair use guidelines are very important. So when you use somebody else's work, even if it's OER, you know, you want to make sure you credit. You know, the good thing is being in academia, we are able to use the free resources, right? You want to still, you know, abide by that when you move online. So the fair use guidelines is where, you know, it helps folks in academia to use copyrighted materials for academic and entertainment purposes. But then, you know, there's still limits on what you can use and how much you can use. So we pay attention to that. And then accessibility, again, I don't know how the scenario there is. You know, here, we definitely have to keep our students with special needs in mind. When you move online, you know, again, there are students who are challenged, who have needs. They mean, like, you know, depending on the type of disability they have, you know, we have to keep in mind to meet their needs. So this is where, you know, that comes into play, having, you know, accessibility policies to academic student needs, and depending on what type of technology use, you know, that's very important. Okay, so that was a quick summary on communication. So communication or facilitation is as important as design. And you need to be present in your online course. You know, just because you've designed it, it doesn't mean the course ends there. You know, you need to be active, use a variety of strategies to communicate with the learners, respond promptly, and provide feedback. You know, so I've done a couple of studies, and what I'll do is I'll share these resources at the end of, you know, our meeting today. And one was on facilitation strategies and one was on engagement strategies. For facilitation strategies, we looked at 12 different facilitation strategies, both from student perspective and instructor perspective, and what worked. And you know what came out the strongest? It was all about the timeliness of your response and timeliness of providing feedback. Very applied strategy. So I'll share that with you. And same way with engagement, I have a whole paper, actually two papers, both from student and instructor perspective on engagement. In terms of how to engage, how to, you know, enhance learner-learner engagement, how to do learner-instructor engagement, and how to do learner-content engagement. I have about 40-some strategies, so I will share that too, you know, because I know that seems to be a topic of interest, and, you know, for today's, we have limited time, so I can't get into detail in that, but I'll be glad to share that with you. So getting into technical, so that's our next, you know, these are two things I'm going to go quickly. I don't have individual slides, but I want to at least, you know, mention it. You know, so to be an efficient online learner, what are some technical competencies you need to have, you know, based on this faculty readiness study. basic computer operations. You know, we live in the day and age, we assume that, you know, everybody can really, you know, you have these basic skills because you need to be able to navigate, you know, a course within LMS, right? You all have to have those skills too. If not, we have to be up to speed and, you know, be ready for it. We still can't assume, you know, that everybody is able to do that. If not, you know, seek out trainings and be prepared for it. And use your roster within the LMS, you know, to do teams and groups. And those are some functionality, you know, not only the roster, whatever functionality is available within your LMS, you know, try it out. You know, that's how you can really make your course engaging. So roster is one if you want to do teams within, you know, do group activities within your LMS. Use different online collaborative tools, right? You could synchronous, I mentioned doing breakout rooms, but also use like, you know, Google Drive is great. You want them to write a paper together. Use like, you know, if you want to use, I don't know if you guys use Dropbox, there's a lot of, you know, these are some that we do here. And there might be some that specifically is being used in India too, right? Look for what are some collaborative tools that, you know, can support your tool. Create and edit videos. End of the day, you know, we all have to do it. You know, whatever tool you have available. Actually, one that I did not, these three, I don't know if you have access to. One I see teachers using a lot is Loom. Have you guys used, do you use Loom now? So Loom is free right now. And it's very easy to create instructor generated videos. L-O-O-M. So the one I use is, I use Camtasia, but you need a license for that. Loom is free. Screencast-O-Matic, you can check that out. I know if, for the free version, you have a limit on how much you can record. And I'm sure there are other tools that you guys use there to do videos, right? Share the tools among each other. Open OER is another big one, right? You want to share open educational resources. Put a repository together so that, you know, each of you can share resources there. Learning websites, resources, games and simulations, you know, whatever is available in terms of OER. Even like, you know, open books are there these days. So you can put a repository together. And I don't, you know, the help desk is structured at Shulini. So that is something, you know, so if somebody has challenges, you need to be able to reach out and ask for support, know how to access, and then, you know, so that you can get proficient and also be able to guide your students if they have technical challenges. I'm sure that's common, right? Anywhere you go, that is a challenge that will be there if you're having challenges. You know, make sure that you reach out and ask questions. So those are some technical competencies. And then I want to quickly go through time management too. So this is a little different. And, you know, not all applies right in the current situation because, you know, so this time management applies for online teaching. Right now, you know, what we're doing is an emergency online teaching. So some of it might apply. So just, you know, think about the situation you're in and what might apply or not. So, you know, if you are going to teach online in the coming semester, take time to start designing. Don't wait till the week before classes start, okay? You always want to have some lead time. In this semester, I think here at my university, we had a week to move. And that might have been the case in a lot of places all over the world. But setting aside that time is important. Scheduling weekly hours to facilitate online course is important. If you're doing, you know, synchronous, you know, you have blocked out time. In asynchronous, it's easy to lose that time, you know? So in asynchronous, you still want to build time together. Like, you know, block out time on your calendar. So this is when I'm going to facilitate. And then use the different features in a learning management system to manage time. If there is an efficient way to do something online, why not, right? Why not do online grading or maintain the online calendar, use rubrics? So all this will, you know, save you time. So that's important. And use facilitation strategies also to manage time. Like if you have a large class, you can always have moderators, right, from your students who can lead the discussions. You can give collective feedback. If you're not able to write to each student, like 100 students individually, you can, like, you know, customize feedback. So this is an issue you're seeing in so many students, like write down the notes and then you could send it to them, right? And then grading scales also helps you with, you know, facilitation. So think through creatively, you know, how you can manage your time. Spend weekly hours to grade assignments. And again, I said, this is the tough one, right? Because it's online, sometimes, you know, grading can take a back seat, but you want to be on top of it. Okay, and always make time to learn about new strategies or tools. Okay, so that's like, you know, going forward, you know, that's something important. We are all in this together. So, you know, we all have to be learning new things, how to do new things. So that was a quick look at technical and time management, but a good time to take some questions before we go into the next section.
Yeah, so Professor Kuldeep is asking a good question. So he says that how much can a teacher be loaded online? What is the optimum time in a week to ensure effectiveness? Like, so how do we make sure he's not overloaded? So what is the right timeline?
So that's I think that's a challenging one for me to answer, because, you know, in context, I think that's very applicable. So I think, you know, so here I can tell you what we do here. So we teach either 3 classes a semester, and, you know, but we also carry a very heavy research load. So depending on your position, how many classes you teach, I think all that comes into play. So in terms of students, when a student asks me, I tell them, how much time should I spend in a course? I tell them at least 10 hours a week for each course you take. You know, so for students, it's easy for me to say. So as an instructor, it's very hard for me to give you like hours, right? How much, you know, especially in terms of if you've already designed it, then all that you're doing is just facilitation. But if you're designing and facilitating on the go, right? Right now, I think that's what we're doing, right? As the week changes, you know, you are designing and facilitating. So both goes hand in hand. And maybe Ashwin can address a little, depending on, you know, how many courses you teach, I think that makes a huge difference.
So, Florence, there was a question on plagiarism. So what kind of softwares or programs do you use at your end to check plagiarism?
Okay, yeah. That's very, very good question. And, you know, and I mentioned academic, you know, dishonesty, right? That's an issue, you know, that's there definitely when you move online. So when you make them write papers, like, you know, we have tools built in within the LMS. So right now, I think we use safe assignment, you know, we use that Turnitin. So these are, you know, tools that can be integrated within the LMS. So when students submit work, it automatically cross checks. But this works great when it is, you know, written papers. But then it does not apply when you are making them build projects. It's not the same, right? You can still run through it, but it's not. What it does, it just checks again against the repository, you know, of resources on the web or from other submissions. So that is one I would say. The other thing with quizzes, that's a big thing, you know, in India. What I would do here, you know, definitely do timed quizzes, right? Give a set of time, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. So even if they are using open book, you know, that which is not exactly, you know, they're not plagiarizing from somebody else, but, you know, you're using resources. Timed quizzes are important. Or what about if they're sharing answers with each other? So in that case, you probably will have to open it and close it at the same time. So they are all taking it, you know, together. So one person is not finishing it and then passing on the answers. Another thing you could do for tests is, I don't know if you give immediate feedback immediately. What we do is you could delay, you know, when the results are shown to them. So making sure that all of them take the quiz and then open the results up for everybody to view it. So that, you know, they don't see the feedback immediately. So nobody knows, you know, how they did on it before they can pass it on. And once they complete it, they cannot access it again. You know, just couple of quick strategies you can think of. We also do, like, you know, proctored exams here. You know, you could look into that if you have to do end of year exams. If you're still doing it online, you know, having cameras on, But again, you know, that gets harder, you know, the larger your classes, I don't know how many you can monitor, but then you at least know that, you know, you can watch them while they are writing. If you have smaller class sizes, you might be able to do that.
Okay. But just a question for my own cost of sounding silly. What is a proctored exam?
So proctored is just monitored, you know, so in any given day, what we do here is even if the class is online, we send the students to different centers to go take a test.
Ah, okay.
Is, you know, watching them while they take it. And we also know this is the student who registered who's taking the test.
Right.
And, you know, it's an issue that you could run into, right?
Okay.
So, yeah, that is what proctored exam is. But now I think, you know, there are groups who are also investing in online proctored exams.
Okay. Yeah.
So you probably have some face recognition, you know, and then you know that this is the student who registered the class who's taking the test, right?
Biometric attendance, for example, or login.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So something to look into. So this is great. I'm actually glad we are asking, you know, we're doing questions along rather than, you know, setting it in the end. So I have two more sections. So let's try and, you know, get through this quickly. So we looked at course design, we looked at communication, we looked at time management and technical, which, you know, I kind of do it. So let's look at us as synchronous online learning environments, which several of you might be using. And I talked about this already, you know, a couple of times in different contexts. So, you know, you can use a variety of features in a synchronous, you know, online platform. And we are all in one today, so which is great. So what are some benefits? Okay, we don't want to overdo it too, right? Because we want to have a balance, because I think, you know, immediacy is important, but at the same time, we want to take advantage of the asynchronous online learning setting as well. So some of the benefits is provide immediate feedback. So if there is a misunderstanding of a concept, you can clearly, you know, explain it, clarify it, reduces feeling of isolation, especially students, you know, who are so used to being with each other and learning, and now they have to do it by themselves. I think synchronous is a nice middle ground to bring them together. Provides a forum for students to collaborate again. You know, you could do some small group activities on synchronous. Fosters a sense of community with the learners. Especially, you know, in this case, if they are already, you know, met their peers and they've moved halfway online, at least they know each other. Imagine when they have to start and finish online, then they may not even know their classmates as well. So, you know, there, that sense of community is important. Motivate students, you know, definitely, and help structure with their time. You know, as much as I talked about time management for faculty, which is important, time management for students are equally important. You think, you know, for them, like when you have that block of time, they have to go to class, you know, and now if you move entirely asynchronous, for them too, you know, they need to become really this self-regulated and self-disciplined person to keep up with all your work, right? So synchronous kind of helps a middle ground where it gives them that structure. It also increases students' technical aptitude, right? They are using some of these new technologies. So here is a screenshot I brought. This is another one of my studies. So I did this when I used to teach synchronous online, and I have the reference. I should have put the reference here. It's on the last slide. You know, so I asked faculty, what are some of the features that you use in a virtual classroom? So if you look at some of the highest. Archiving the session was like the rate at the highest, because, you know, even if students don't log in, they record it and they wanted to share it with others. But this was a US centered study, you know, and then viewing the webcam. So they like to see you, audio chat, they like to hear you, text chat. So this was on a scale of 4, okay, 1 to 4. So if I have to stop, you know, even the 2s were agree, okay. Strongly agree was in the 3s, 2s were agree. They liked, you know, sharing web links. They liked sharing e-board. E-board is the whiteboard, you know, where the instructor used to write. They liked hand raising, application sharing. So I kind of stopped there. So some of, you know, the technologies that instructors liked to use in the classroom. Okay. And So what are some ways you can use asynchronous online? So again, this is coming straight from research, okay? In open-ended comments, we found, again, this is an article I would recommend you to check it out. Interaction was the big one, right? We all know. That's why there were so many questions on engagement. You know, so they said interaction by interaction, this was great. And then community, which I mentioned, right? To build that community. And for students to connect from multiple locations. And I think in this situation, we are forced to connect from multiple locations. It's not a choice, right? It also gives an opportunity for field experiences, you know, still talk synchronously when they are on the field. And then for collaboration, to connect with each other and, you know, work on projects, adaptation. So, you know, so for someone moving quickly online, this is a first step, you know, where you could take lessons and teach it synchronously without having to make a whole lot of adaptation, like as an asynchronous, but you still have to do some adaptation, right? So you have to adapt the activities, but then there's still room for you to lecture. So they mentioned that virtual office hours, you know, I didn't talk about that until now. So that is another important one. You know, every week you can set aside an hour for virtual office hours. So if somebody has questions, they can log in to talk to you. Which is very helpful, and you can use it, use synchronous tools for that. Presentation opportunities are great, right? If you design opportunities for them to present at the end of the semester, it's great for them to do it on a synchronous setting. And these could be team presentations, individual presentations. It's another knowledge check, right? Another way for you to test their learning. In addition to the tests and exams you do, you could also make them do presentations. So that is synchronous. Actually, you know what, let's take a minute before we go to the last section. I would actually like to hear both for questions, but I would like to hear, assuming you all do a lot synchronous, what other ways have you used synchronous for?
Anybody wants to take that?
So anyone? Yes, Amar sir, please go ahead.
What other ways, what was the question?
So what are some ways you use synchronous online learning in your courses right now?
Actually, I teach drawing, engineering drawing. So it was an abrupt shift from classroom teaching to this thing. So I faced quite a lot of problems initially. So what I used to do is, like, I'm teaching how to draw an isometric projection of different views. So firstly, I recorded some videos and sent them to uploaded to my online account, then shared the link. So next I thought of sharing some external resources while I was on Big Blue Button. I shared some video and played that. So I think in these kind of subjects, there are some problems, like drawing subjects. Another thing which I would like to share with you all is what I faced while we were talking about integrity of the students. So what happened was, I gave an assignment on this drawing some questions. So I told them to write down their roll numbers while attempting the question on each page. So, and submit those drawings online in a PDF format. So while I was going through them, so I found that most of them were same drawings. What they did was, they just edited in paint and changed the roll number, and just similar kind of drawings one student attempted and it was copied by many others. So that was the one or two things which I faced and do.
Yeah.
Who wants to share the current scenario of our synchronous learning that we're going through? So like,
thank you for sharing that. Yeah.
Anyone else who would like to share his experience through?
Can I share?
Yeah, surely, ma'am. Sure.
So apart from regular interactions in classes, where we can also conduct online polls, like on the spot quizzes we are doing in the class, which is a part of synchronous online classroom. As a part of the class, we upload a quiz on the presentation and we do on the spot polls. So that is something which is synchronous.
Great. Yeah, that's great. Then you know that, you know, each person is doing it, right?
Yeah. How many students have attended?
A test for check. I think that's a great strategy.
How many students have listened to the lecture? That also gives us a clear view of how many students are actually interacting with us. Yeah.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good strategy.
Hi, Florence.
Hi.
Can you hear me? Hi, yes. Gurjot here. Very nice session. I'm actually planning to give presentation opportunities to my students after the exam. And I also use this MCQs in tutorial time to keep them engaged, and they reply to the chat box for interaction.
Thank you for sharing that. Yeah. So multiple choice questions. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So we have about 9 minutes. So let's keep moving, you know, to the last section. Actually, this ties in really well because I was going to spend a few minutes on assessment and evaluation. Again, I think the concept of assessment and evaluation is very different in India compared to what we do here, at least, you know, from my perception. But as I said, you know, try and have as many formative, you know, assessments. We just heard ma'ams talk about quizzes, discussions. So just not heavily on, you know, the exams and final papers. Those are important, but then, you know, build it in. Build other activities in. You know, you could do, so final projects could be text-based, multimedia. You could have them record themselves in a presentation and submit it, you know, make it individualized. So that's where, you know, some the plagiarism can be avoided. But I agree, you know, when you teach a topic, when you teach a subject like engineering drawing, you know, it is challenging, right? You want them to be able to do their own project. And the thing is, it's project-based. So ideally, each person should be able to do their own thing. You know, maybe think about different giving them a choice of different questions, or, you know, I'm just trying to brainstorm, you know, how can you avoid the whole class, you know, submitting the same assignment, thinking through that. And I also, you know, one thing that I like to do, again, I don't know if it works in that context there, and depending on what level you teach, I have people review each other's work, like peer evaluation and peer assessments, to give feedback, especially if you're building something, you know, you're creating something, which they do a lot in the content I teach. You know, mine is also a lot of project-based, right? So they give feedback, then they take the feedback and they have to improve, and then they have to submit it to me. So when it comes to me, they've received one round of feedback. So, you know, think about if that works in your situation. Self-assessments too, you know. So the multiple choice tests, you know, you give them immediate feedback as soon as they take it, could be taken as self-assessment. I even make them reflect. You know, students don't like that. But, you know, to any learning, a student should be able to reflect to see what they got out of it. Right? They usually don't see the benefits immediately. So, you know, thinking through how, whatever they learned in that topic, how does it benefit them? How does that apply to, you know, other things that they do? So thinking about like reflection papers, you know, think through that. So you want to use a variety of course assessments. That's what I want to say. Don't just rely on one, you know, use a variety, both, you know, traditional and authentic assessments. You know, you could still do like papers and tasks and projects, but then, you know, do authentic is like, you know, more hands-on, you're building it. You know, I've heard of people here like teach even dance online. Right? Thinking about content, you know, you could teach, name it, you know, our the other group that really have a lot of online courses on my campus is nursing, health educators, you know, so they are ahead, you know, like usually it's education and, you know, the health folks. So they are able to teach those subjects, you know, so the nurses use a lot of simulations and, so, I mean, we have to just create it, you know, not limit ourselves. You know, we all have challenges, no matter, you know, what content we teach, but look beyond it and see, okay, and you could be the innovator in your area, okay? So think, how can I teach this online? So as I said, you know, someone can teach dance online. You know, now, you know, exercising online is becoming the trend here, right? Watching videos and people exercising. So think about, you know, whatever ways that you can do, you know, to teach them, and then hopefully you'll be successful. Use rubrics, end of the day, I would say clearly, you know, they need to know how you're going to grade it. And maybe that'll make a difference, what your expectations are. So one thing you could also do, I was trying to think, you know, in that example we heard about engineering drawing, along with the drawing, maybe have them write a paragraph on how they did that. Like, you know, so they need to know how they drew, right? They cannot just submit somebody's work. Write out a few steps or something like that, you know? So that, you know, we can avoid plagiarism. So evaluation is critical in, you know, online, and I'm sure you do this in face-to-face as well. So collect feedback whenever you can, because you don't see them face-to-face. You want to be able to get feedback mid-semester, anytime you have a checkpoint, you know, to make sure everything is going well, they're getting everything they need. And end of semester, do peer feedback, which I mentioned. And then, and this is probably for the administrative team, you know, even looking at a quality assurance process for the online courses. So we do that here in the US. I mentioned Quality Matters is one, you know, so making sure online courses have the elements, you know, of systematic design in there, and, you know, they are well designed so that, you know, learning can be more effective. End of the day, you know, every time I teach, you always learn. There's always room for improvement with the next iteration. So what I do is, you know, I go through my questions in the Contact the Instructor forum. I keep save them. And then the next time I teach it, I try and address all that in my design and in my facilitation. Because if your student had a question, that means something was not clear, right? So always keep track of feedback and try and, you know, improve it the next time you teach it, because there's always room for us to continuously improve, right? So I know that was a quickly packed an hour and a half. We described online learning, and then, you know, we quickly looked at best practices in our online teaching through the lens of course design, course communication, technical time management. Briefly, we talked about synchronous online learning and assessment and evaluation. You know, I teach a 3-credit-hour course on designing online learning, which is 15 weeks long. So, you know, this is like a quick version of, you know, some of the topics. I know you all have a lot of lot more questions. Maybe we'll take a couple more questions before we wrap up.
Yeah, surely, ma'am. So I'll take up a couple of questions.
One second. Can I just make a couple of remarks and then we can take the
questions? Surely, ma'am.
So one thing that is coming out of the session, Florence, is that a lot of people would be interested in knowing, you know, how, for example, in your university, maybe somebody is designing a science course or teaching it online or taking it online if they were doing it in traditional classroom. So can I request you for a guest session, maybe if somebody is willing to do it for us, that would be so great. I don't know if it is possible or not, but that's just an idea I'm throwing out.
I can look into it.
Yeah.
No, I don't know top of my head. I'm sure there are some experts, you know, I can definitely look into it.
Yeah. So another thing is that during the chat, we are getting a lot of questions which are related, basic questions related to our own LMS or very basic questions regarding online teaching. So I just want to mention here, Florence, and also for the benefit of all the faculty members attending, that we are, you know, looking at it. What happened is eUniversity was started, the eUniv platform was started, but our move from the traditional or the 0% that you mentioned of a traditional classroom to the, you know, the web based or towards blended happened a little slowly. So we are not adapted fully to the platform. So we are taking this as an opportunity to retrain the people on Moodle, LMS, etc. And our team is making an effort to do that. Mm. So some of the questions that came up today will be sorted when that training happens. The third thing is that basically
Okay, I skipped my mind. The third point, I'll remember it a little later. We can go to the questions right now. Kamal, can you take over?
Just that I'll take. And then we'll like finally wind up for the day. So there's a question by Dr. Rohit from Pharma, and he says that what is the possibility of incorporation of a simulation software for science practical based learning? Like, how is it done? So there are people who are like, because ours being a research oriented organization, so there are a lot of like people who are into research, high time research, and they're more concerned about the lab component or the practical component of the subject. So are there like any best practices like simulation softwares or something like that that are being adopted?
So again, as I said, you know, that was a challenge here too, but you know, some of these simulations do come with a cost. But a lot of vendors are giving reduced rates during, you know, right now for COVID-19. So looking at it, and you can integrate them, you know, into your LMS if you want to build it in, putting the links. So definitely, you know, and that site, you know, I mentioned, I'll share it again. You know, it has a, I have a repository of different virtual labs that you could look into. And there might be some free ones too. I don't know. I haven't really, you know, I've not taken the time to look into it. So best practices wise, again, you know, try it out, you know, be creative and try it out. I don't know if people have done this online yet, you know, very few maybe if they have. So you might have to be the innovator, you know, again, go to research. That's what I would say. And look at it, because if you had a choice to do it face to face, and people would do it face to face, but now, you know, in this situation, everybody is forced to do it, right? So I'm not sure how many folks have really experimented, you know, some of those labs online.
Again, another question that is like quite common in here, and it's around the rubrics, so assessment rubrics. So we know that it is around like the level of difficulty. We know it is around the level of learning on Bloom's taxonomy. So is there a divide between like the UG and PG students for the rubrics? Are there any model rubrics that have been designed for specific courses or something like? So Dr. Kesri was there who's asking this question. There were like a couple of others. So are there any model rubrics which are designed, which we can implement? Or we have to like take a call on our
own? So, you know, the rubrics are directly aligned to your course and your content. So it's hard for you to, I mean, you could look at existing rubrics. For example, if you're making them do a presentation, then, you know, you can look and see what are the elements that are important when someone does a presentation or when they're writing a paper. But then you still will have to include items that are very specific to your, you know, project or to particular to your course. So I have usually, you know, I've looked at rubrics like that, you know, the general ones. I'm sure there might be rubrics out there. I've not really gone looking, but then you might still have to, based on, you know, the assignment requirement you write, you create a rubric used of that, based on that, right? I have not looked for rubrics specifically, but I'm sure there are out there.
Right. So that's all, I think. And
I have a question.
So just to give you,
just
I would also like to just give a small note.
Yeah, yeah.
And
so let me ask the question.
It was like,
yeah.
Yeah, surely, ma'am. Surely.
So there was a question initially when we started, a couple of people were asking that. And I remember when we had a chat, Florence, you also mentioned that even in the US, connectivity is an issue sometimes. So in a small state like Himachal and with our students in very remote areas, sometimes connectivity is an issue. So any specific tips as to how to overcome that challenge? Do we make it more asynchronous? Any strategies that you have used that have worked? Just something about that.
Yeah, great question. And, you know, you think that in a country like the US, you know, we shouldn't have connectivity issues. But trust me, there's still a lot of connectivity issues. Because right now, you know, we're facing that even in our K-12, right? Our school children, or also going through online learning. My own kids are doing online learning, right? Their instructions are all created on the LMS. So not everybody has access to the internet, and or maybe they have periodic access. They may have a device, may not have a device. They are using, they're sharing a device among siblings, right? So all those factors need to taken into account. So that's where I said, you know, don't rely entirely on synchronous, right? Balance, have an asynchronous presence that they can also do self-paced. Maybe they can find, you know, a place where they can go have access to Wi-Fi, or, you know, get a laptop from somebody and they can use it. But if they have, like, imagine if they're taking 5 classes and all 5 of you are doing like 5 synchronous sessions, that is expecting the student to sit through, you know, a synchronous session all day long, right? And that's the same thing that happened here too, you know. So that was causing an issue, and so slowly, you know, we were recommending faculty, you know, to think about a blend of asynchronous and synchronous. Right. So that's definitely a recommendation, and hopefully, you know, there are initiatives in India from the government, and you know, in India the good thing is they can also get those data cards, right? Is that still an option there? Here we can do that, you know, it's not even a choice here. So, you know, you have to have internet access at home, and a lot of rural areas, we don't even, you know, have internet access still.
Amal, you want to mention something about connectivity and your last comments?
Yeah, so the connectivity was the one that I would have liked to. So that was something that was pretty common in all the comments in the beginning. And just to like update Florence on like the initiative that we started with her, like in 2013, back there in 2013, I suppose we had the first faculty development program when Florence came over to Shulini. And so just to update her on like current proceedings in UNIF. So in terms of like course structuring, so we have the learning outcomes, we have the skill outcomes, we have the course objectives of pretty much every course aligned there. Mm-hmm. In terms of taking assessments like quizzes, assignments. So in terms of all these, we are pretty much right up there. But what we like lack at this point of time is like, one, notifications, sending out notifications to students through our LMS. So we're not doing mm-hmm. that, I suppose. And we are not into peer-to-peer learning. So discussion mm-hmm. forums, we lack at this point of time. And and the analytics part. So we'll try to cover it up, right? And we would like to have a session with you if you have a time, anytime, right? So we'd like to have a session on particularly these things that we lack actually right now. And that's all. Any last thoughts from you, Florence ma'am?
No, I think you guys are doing great, you know. You have at least infrastructure in place. You know, I'm doing another workshop for another Indian university. And, you know, at least you guys have thought ahead. You have the LMS and, you know, some of you were trained early on. So, you know, just hang in there. And, you know, so hopefully we'll all get through this. And then when life returns to normal, hopefully, you know, a lot of the lessons that you learn from this will be retained. Okay, so that we don't just return to our old ways, you know, the pedagogy of teaching, right, is very, very important. And, you know, so that we can capitalize on all, you know, the technology that is out there to teach our students. So it was great. You know, I'm glad I got to join and talk to you all. And it was good to see some of the names. I remember some, and I think Kesari ma'am, right? She was there. Yeah,
Kesari ma'am has been our champion of e-university.
Yeah, I remember. I still remember she asked me some tough questions when I came.
I hope that, you know, I just wrote in the chat that I just hope that you read it. I think that we are not far, far behind. Very soon you will see us the champion and leader in this online education.
Many good to hear
we are already doing.
Very nice. Very glad.
So most of the things we are already doing, and you know, there are few things only where we need to practice. But one last thought from your side, and how do we make ourselves comfortable in front of the camera?
So, I mean, I don't know. I think, you know, you just think, you know, you're the expert, right? You're the expert, you know, don't worry about the look. You know, it's the content you teach right? You're the expert, and the students are there to listen to you. So don't worry about
maybe anything. maybe again the same mantra, practice.
Yeah, practice, and then you know the same, like you're teaching in face to face, you know. So it's like when you're standing up and teaching in the class, you don't worry about, you know, other things, right? You are in control. You are the expert there. You know, just think about the same thing. You're just teaching. So, and you know, it's okay if we don't, everything doesn't come out the way that we want it to be. You know, it's all about teaching and learning. We are all in this together. So you don't have to be perfect, right? So I think it's okay. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Lovely talking to you.
Oh, same here. Okay. Thank you all. Goodbye to everybody.
Thank you all.
Okay. Thanks.
Especially thanks to the faculty from SILBE as well. So our friend from SILBE also, I could see quite a few. Yeah. And thank you, ma'am. Ashu ma'am, to you also, and Florence ma'am. So thank you very much, and we would like to have more of these sessions moving forward.
Organizing.
So thank you to all the faculty members.
Organizing this would have been such a nightmare in a normal situation, but look how easily we did it. So that is like another learning.
Exactly.
Absolutely. So thank you again, Florence, and thank you everybody who joined in. Thanks a lot. Hopefully we'll meet again soon.
Sure. And did we have about 150 participants today?
Yes, we did.
More than 150.
Okay, very nice. Okay, good to hear.
So also we'll be picking up some questions we might have lost. And I'll be sending it across to you.
Yeah, make sure you copy-paste, you know, the questions so that you can keep track of them.
Surely. I'll not copy-paste. We can have an access to the chat.
Yeah. Oh, you can. So the chat also gets recorded?
Yes.
Oh, that's nice. The chat gets saved too. Okay, very nice.
So we are discovering this as we go along.
Very nice. Okay.
Right. Bye, everybody. Thank you, everyone.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Thanks a lot.